What's up, guys? Chase Curtis here with another episode of Inside SML presented by our friends at O'Neill Racing. As usual, we have some breaking news to discuss in this episode, so let's get into it. Now, the biggest news of the week is easily the announcement that Triumph Racing and Joey Savatgy have ended their partnership prematurely, as Joey will not be contending this weekend or in the final playoff rounds of the series aboard that Triumph. In regards to the breakup, Triumph Racing released this statement. A mutual decision between both parties sees the American move on to new opportunities ahead of the upcoming Super Motocross World Championship. Despite extensive efforts to restore Joey's 2VDSX eligibility, it was only recently confirmed that the Georgia native would be unable to line up for the 2025 2VD Supercross campaign. We'd like to thank Joey for everything he's done since joining the team last winter and wish him well for the 2025 season. Joey Savatgy also released this statement. Firstly, I would like to thank Triumph Racing for giving me the opportunity to race for the team this year. We were all hoping the AMA rule would be amended to allow me to race 2VD Supercross next year, but unfortunately, this didn't happen. Triumph knows how hard it was for me to sit out half the season this year, and they were nice enough to give me the option to be released early in order for me to race a full season next year. Thanks again to the whole team, and I wish them all the best for the future. So in conclusion, this decision all boils down to the fact that Joey is unable to race 2VD Supercross next year in the 2025 season. If you recall, originally Triumph's intentions were for Joey to race the 250 outdoors this year and then line up on their all-new 450 platform in the 2025 season. However, it's almost certain now that Triumph will not have a 450 ready to compete before next winter, which basically just means Joey would have to do the same schedule that he did in 2024 in 2025. And as he stated, that is not something he wants to consider for really kind of the prime of his career. If you think about it, Joey's 450 career has definitely been full of some obstacles. He came out swinging aboard the Monster Energy Kawasaki and certainly should have received a ride from his performances that year. But obviously Adam Cincerillo was moving into the class and taking that bike. And then the JGR situation didn't really unfold well for him as he had a brutal injury off season to that leg or ankle. And yeah, it's just from that point, it's really been hard for him to get into a steady team and something he's deserving, which is something we see all too often, and especially in the 450 class as of late, as there's just not as many rides as they need to be available for some of these 250 guys that are winning championships or battling for championships and moving up. Honestly, I think a lot of this has to do with just how much longer racers' careers have been in the recent decade. We see how Eli Tomac just extended his career another year when really we all thought he possibly would be retiring last year. So whatever it is that's making these riders have longer careers is definitely a topic for another video, as we can do a whole probably 20-minute discussion on debating on what exactly those factors are. In conclusion, with this situation, obviously the summer did not go as planned for Triumph Racing or Joey Savatgy, as Joey definitely showed speed at times, but if we're being honest, he came into the season as probably one of the favorites to get at least a moto win, and we just saw a lot of issues, whether it's just with him or his bike. Frankly, most of the mechanical issues we believe were electrical based, which I would look for the team to be switching partnerships or whatever relationship they have that is causing that would probably be a little bit different in the 2025 season, just to avoid those issues from happening next outdoor season. But guys, I've spent some time on this machine in recent months, and it's an amazing, phenomenal bike out of the box, especially when you consider that this is their first jab and their first attempt at a dirt bike. It's just a great bike all around, but I think this goes to say how brutal and how gnarly an outdoor season is, especially when it's your first attempt as a team or as a manufacturer as a whole. They had zero data. They really were developing as the season went on and figuring out the bike. And yeah, it's just when you put some of the fastest guys in the world on the fastest and gnarliest and roughest tracks in the country for multiple hours on a day, things are bound to happen when you don't have that much experience and knowledge regarding the bike. So yeah, I would look for them to have a better year next year. Obviously, this was their first try at it and things didn't go exactly how they wanted. But all in all, I think they had some great moments together, and it's unfortunate to see it end prematurely. So what does this mean for Joey's future? Well, we have already heard some rumblings that him and Firepower Honda are in talks for 2025. Really, when it comes down to it, we already talked about this, but it's pretty hard to find a 450 ride that's maybe factory level support or just a good privateer effort these days, especially when it's this late in silly season. Joey's unfortunately joining the silly season talk late again, which is something he's had to do a couple times in his career, I believe. So there's not a lot of options for him to go, but I do believe that we will find him on a bike that is deserving and he can show his true potential on in the 2025 season. So obviously we will not see Joey on the starting line this weekend or the remainder of the year. And another rider we will not see is Daxon Bennick, as Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha announced last week that he will be sitting out the remainder of the year to focus on his health. Moving on to some riders that will be coming back to the races that we have not seen in a while. Pro Circuit Monster Energy Kawasaki's Cameron McAdoo has been back on the bike for a while now. We've seen him do some laps at Paula and Glen Helen throughout the week for probably 2 months now. So he's looking good and he will be back on the starting line this weekend, which is exciting for him. He is gonna have to go to the LCQ though, so that'll be interesting for sure. This is one thing I'm not real excited about when it comes to the Super Motocross playoffs, just the fact that these riders that are stuck in the LCQs will be stuck in them for all three rounds rather than it being based off the previous round's results. But hey, that's something that Cameron's gonna have to overcome, and I'm sure it'll be exciting to watch him make his way to the top or battle it out in the LCQs before moving on to the mains. Another rider you haven't seen or heard from for a while is Carson Mumford, and he too will be back on the starting line this weekend, this time aboard his new ride, his Firepower Honda CRF250R. Carson has been back east testing and training with the team for a while now, so we would look for him to come out swinging this weekend and have some great results through these last three rounds of the year. Onto the 450 class, obviously Jet Lawrence will be making his return to racing after his injury in the outdoors. He's had, I think, 2 or 3 weeks on the bike now, but this will be the first time we see him on the 2025 model, so that'll also be something interesting to watch. Honestly, if we're talking about the 2025 season, this is a big week and a big series for Jet Lawrence and Chase Sexton. If Jet comes out here and he's not 100% from what we've heard and starts winning, it's gonna be a really, really rough off season for some of these other guys to gain confidence. Justin Barcia will also be back at the races after his premature drop out of the Pro Motocross Championship due to some knee injuries. He's a little bit of a question mark as I don't believe he had surgery or anything to fix those knees. I think he just needed some time off the bike. So I think this might be a little bit of a test to see how good those knees are after some time off riding. Now, before we end this week's episode of Inside SML, if you have not already, be sure to check out our 2025 450 shootout that went live Wednesday morning. If you are looking for a more in-depth review and some knowledge and facts from the test riders based on every single bike, be sure to head to swapmotolive.com and read the full in-depth write-up from the shootout. Anyways, that is all I have for you guys in this week's episode. As always, thank you for tuning in. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and let's get amped up for some racing this weekend. See you guys next week.